think about what you're doing in your own work as well. I was reminded by my wife Linda that again, coloristic painters have worked. What I hope will happen in the presentation today is that you'll have some new, somewhat self-explanatory as we go through it. You'll see that there's some text with it so that, you know, you can read it. I won't read all the stuff to you, but I think, you know, pretty much it'll be fairly clear along with the comments I'd like to make. So, looking at. We see what we know and we know what we see. This is a very kind of circular problem. And I think how we define the things that we're seeing is certainly going to have a big influence on what we do as a painter. Frequently when I was teaching vision and art about the biology of seeing was an important one because it helps to identify the nature of how our eyes, the tonal range of light as it affects it. So that things like a red shirt suddenly doesn't look so red anymore. The vivid hues that we see tend not to be very vivid anymore under low-light color. Is that if we can't see distinctions, then it's going to be hard for us to make important ones as painters in each thing that we see. So there's a color, but we need to be able to identify its hue, not only its hue, but its tonality and its intensity, its degree of brightness or dullness. So what would you say that is? You have to identify it by the three traits.
Here we go.
Okay? Enough agreement that that's sort of what we're saying? Okay. So one of the things that Andrea said, which is interesting, first she said blue, then she said red. Oh, then purple. Because when we're thinking about where the hue is, it's part of a kind of gradient of the color circle. And so identifying, oh, is this a more red-violet or a more blue-violet? As we get more subtle with those distinctions, that kind of difference makes a big difference. Now, what about this? How can we define our three traits here?
Green or yellow, blue, and
squint at the screen, and what you'll see, this is again one of those things we'll get to in just a minute. Look at the boundary between this and this, this and this. Mm-hmm. Okay, you see how it's like the purplish one has more clarity to its boundary. The bottom one, despite how vivid it is, so high in saturation as a yellow-green, screaming at us as yellow-green, it's like if you squint, that edge wants to disappear a little bit. So that's our tonal relationship. So now, this idea of the itsy-bitsy spike. So we have, you know, a violet that's medium value, not so pure, against what? A yellow, slightly greenish, light, and very vivid. So when we put those things together, and we say, well, how would they begin to interact if they're in our painting next to each other? When we think of the three traits.
They're all in the text.
That, say it again, Kevin?
The intensity.
Yeah, they're all like it, the purest of each of the hues. Where's red? Middle value. Okay? So you gotta remember how the hue exists in its pure state. We're missing something in our ability to give structure to our paintings. We'll be getting into more of that as we go along. But this way of representing, I think, this hue value connection, and oh, there's its complement, purple on the bottom. But we're not thinking, oh, look at how light this is and how dark that is. We're forgetting, again, our three little itsy-bitsy spider elements. So when everything is pure, they're going like that. So they can be dropping down in value, but not intensity. But if we're going to drop it down as value, but not shift it either way, you know, in towards green or towards red, that's basically what our painting is. It's a combination of colors that are next to each other that create an effect, and that's going to read as either space, light, depth, you know, volume. There's a mixed complement there. So having it, and so in pigments, pigments are different from light as color. Light as color is additive. Okay, won't go into that. But in pigment, it's subtractive. Because you mix two colors together, they become less pure. That's why a lot of people like to buy extra tubes of interesting colors, turquoise or, you know, lavender or something, because to try to mix it away from a different pigment source. That's what the manufacturers do. They can give you all these other variations by going to a different pigment source that gives you something that's a little more vivid. And it's altered in how it appears because of what?
Here
looks dark. Over here, what? It looks light. Over here, it disappears. Each one of these yellows is the same. Each one of these lines is the same. This is part of that magic of painting. So look at down here. It's like, look, that just looks like shoe polish. You know, dark brown matches the tone here. And we're losing it here. Okay, the value that this stands out quite strong, that asterisk. But over here, we sort of see it as almost like a reddish circle. And this looks very light. Suddenly it's like, wow, those really pop out. So in each, we say, oh, wow, man, it's like, I like that blue. Hey, oh, look at that. Is that orange? Or I think I'll get that. Oh, and it says it's, what, Indian yellow, so it's transparent. Wow, that, yeah. So it's like our paint is our important tool. You want to understand from the tube, when you squeeze it out, hue, value, saturation. What are the traits of the color that he's using?
It's more dark and saturation together.
So what's this? Again, we want to think of colors adjacent to each other. Okay, so what gives this shape its context is both this and this, and they're not just red. So the shadow colors aren't the same hue, just darker. And that's giving it a certain liveliness. Look at how this kind of quite turquoisey kind of blue is playing off of that really strong sort of red-orange quality to the feet and the ankles. You can almost feel the heat of the day, the temperature, and how things move from one area to another. If you look at things like, look at these colors, and look at how it moves us to here, up into here. This, you know, this wall isn't that color. That's not that color, you know? So all those different kinds of yellows help to make for what? Luminosity. There's a kind of glow to this. Even though he's got strong shadow shapes, look at how the fact that this as the quote shadow isn't very dark. So how do you make a shadow read as a shadow but not make it dark? The intensity is the same. So it's a very subtle hue shift. This is a little more greenish, it's a little bit more, you know, yellowish, and that stands out. Look at the way in which he's treating this little crossing of the shadow of the window frame on the white window frame. Not necessarily. We worked with value. Do charcoal drawings, Dante grid drawings, wash drawings, value only. They value more. You get to now going into painting class. What are you thinking of? Darks make shadows, lights make light. But we've already discovered that that's not necessarily true. You don't have to make this. What's that?
Pastels.
He also does a lot of pastels too. Yes, purposes. It that gave him, he was, I would say, a painter who started drawing from observation, but then painted imaginatively, or I would call it synthetically, back in the studio. So he's not looking at the model and the setup. He has it drawn, and then he's painting it based on with this magenta ground, and then tries to leave it in as many places as possible. Like all the trees, trunks in the middle are just the ground of the imprimatur left, and she's painting the negative spaces around it. And because she's in a place that feels hot and muggy all the time, that has served her well. And she's also a very high chroma painter, but still interested in value and structure too. What is he doing? It's like, I can't, it's like, why would he put, you know, mint green down the nose and then the dab of yellow? But, gee, if I have this red, sort of crimson-y kind of color floating, I'm going to make that stand out more. I'm still too tied to local color. If that sofa's red, I'm going to think I have to paint it red. So I said to myself, as part of a figure group of or five of us, we painted every Wednesday night. And so I said, okay, I'm gonna paint with limited palettes. So I pick a complementary pair, black and white and buff titanium. And these are in a show in the Bowery Gallery, New York in 2000. And so I did a lot of paintings where I put stuff on a mirror, and then, so it's against the window, the folding screen and stuff like that. And so, Charles LeClaire, now deceased, was my graduate school dean at the Tyler School of Art. It's a very good painting book. About painting in Japan, it's the opposite. Mm-hmm. So, we can't assume everybody thinks the same. And then color and meaning, art, science, and symbolism. A really wonderful book that explores many ideas about how art has altered its focus over the centuries from cave painting to contemporary painting. Same kind of color for the same end results. So someone like Vuillard over here, a lot of these colors are very neutralized, sort of dulled down. But yet, all of the kind of dynamic stuff that we've been talking about is in it, it's soft voice. So this is the soft voice version. I'm screaming. Modigliani, basically a warm, cool, earthy kind of palette. David Hockney is a very hue-driven, pure kind of color paintings. I don't know if you've seen any of the shows, the books, amazing painter in watercolor too. I don't know how I can do it at that scale in a day. So each of these were a way to try to highlight the fact that how you use your colors, how you mix your colors, the purpose of your colors is going to end up driving the experience that the viewer gets of your work. So if you're thinking, I need it to be more vivid, well then, you're going to use color in a different way than like the Vuillard, which is to make it feel like, everything's kind of quiet and soft, and here's a white tablecloth, and here's a delicate vase, and that kind of thing. But still, all of those same traits that we've talked about need to be incorporated into your choices.